We light this candle as a reminder that Jesus Christ is the light of the world and walks with us each and every day when we say, thanks be to God. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. Welcome to this time and this place and this space of worship. Welcome to this time where we gather together as God's people. We have been called here together today. You have been called here. For some reason, at some time, you answered that call. You said yes. Yes to coming together as a community. Yes to gathering in this place. Yes to worship today. And for that, well, it's just amazing. It's awesome. It's spectacular. We are here together. We belong here together. This is our time. This is our space. This is our place of worship. And as we gather to share this time of worship, let us pause to remember that we worship on lands that are by law, the unceded lands of the Mi'kmaqi, the ancestral territory of the Mi'kmaq people. May we live with respect for this land and peace and friendship with its people. Our announcements have been handed out, and they've been distributed in all various ways, which we share our news and what's happening in the congregation. And so let's just have a moment to look through what's happening today and this week and what's coming up. You may notice in the bulletin right away that the Valley View Villa worship service has been canceled. I was talking to them earlier this week, and they have COVID currently in several areas of the building and asked us for health reasons just to stay away until they can get that cleared up. So we do hold the people of Valley View Villa, the residents and the staff, in our thoughts and in our prayers. Tuesday and Wednesday, closures are in the parlor. On Tuesday night at 6 p.m., the Christian Education Committee is meeting. And Christian Education looks after the Sunday school and any other education events or things like Bible study or special events that we have here at the church. If this is something that you feel called to, if you'd like to know more about Christian education and how we form it and how we provide it here from St. Paul, you're more than welcome to join and explore what it means to be part of the Christian education ministry. Coming up on October 1st, we have the Pictou County Council of Churches meeting here. And if you'll notice on the other page, our congregation is hosting the Pictou County Council of Churches meeting. And three or four helpers are needed on Monday, September 30th at 6 p.m. to help with food preparation. And on Tuesday, October 1st in the morning from 9 to 1 for serving and for cleaning up. If you would like to, if you've been called to this and you would like to join with those who are organizing this wonderful meeting with the Pictou County Council of Churches, you are more than welcome to join and sign up in the narthex. And if you're not sure what needs to be done, I'm sure somebody can let you know how those requirements will be. It's just basically setting up, preparing, and cleaning up. So. The Westville Fire Department is going to be worshiping with us on August the 6th, and we're so pleased to have them here for the beginning of Fire Prevention Week, and I'm going to welcome worship time with them. On October 13th, we're going to have the dedication of our pew Bibles, and October 19th, we're going to have our pie sale. And so, pies are going to be sold again for $8 each, and there's a limit of 5 per family.
Eight.
8 per family? Wow. We're moving on up. I don't know if my waistline can handle 8 pies, but now I feel called to this challenge. So 8, I'm going to fix this. 8. Sign up this as an Arabic if you're interested, and you can give approximately, if you could, give approximately 3 hours of your time. And at 9 a.m. on October 19th, please sign up and sheet in the Arabic in the front porch there, or call Janice and let her know. And if you are coming, please remember to bring your vegetable peeler, your knife, or your rolling pin. I have some information about some generous donations. Donations have been made to the general fund in memory of Paula Woodrow Henderson by Wendy Monroe. And donations have been made to the general fund in memory of June Cameron and Alice McDonald by Peter and Lori Frisia. Anniversary greetings. Hello. Anniversary greetings that we said to Wilfred Doris. Today is your anniversary, so glad that you could spend it with us. 51 years. Wow, congratulations. That is wonderful. Birthday greetings. We're going to be sharing our birthday greetings that are listed in our bulletin and our anniversary greetings on Facebook and Instagram every week. And if you'd like your birthday to be included, please send a message to the church Facebook page by the end of the day on Tuesday of each week so we can get it in the Sunday bulletin. Also, obituary and funeral notices. If you recently lost a loved one and would like your obituary shared in the St. Paul Facebook page, please send a message with the details to our church Facebook page. You may also contact our social media moderator, Wendy Monroe, directly at her email, or you can call the office. And the social media moderator title was given to Ms. Monroe because she is doing a wonderful job running all of our social media. If you think things are love posts and things that you're seeing on Facebook and Instagram, that's all thanks to Wendy. She's doing a phenomenal job. Let's say thank you, Wendy. I'm going to get trouble after this, but it's worth it. And also we have our continued support of the food bank, and our counter distributors and coffee makers are listed there. Again, if this is a ministry you might feel called to, please let me know. We can join you in with the group. Do you have any birthdays to celebrate today? No birthdays? That's okay. We'll save them up. I'm sure there's some coming up soon, if I remember correctly. So, if there's nothing... Oh, and other things. Oh my gosh. This is... Sorry. Next Sunday, following church, there's a special meeting of the UCW. It will be downstairs. So, if you are a UCW member, or if you know of UCW members, please let them know that next Sunday, following church, there'll be a meeting of the UCW downstairs. Also, next Sunday, I know I apologize, it's not in the bulletin, I missed, this is the bulletin deadline, but next Sunday is Orange Shirt Day. It's the day in which we recognize Truth and Reconciliation, and because Truth and Reconciliation Day is the next day on Monday, so next Sunday, if you have an orange shirt, if you can buy an orange shirt, or a scarf, something orange to wear, next Sunday is the day for wearing orange as we explore our part of Truth and Reconciliation as members of the United Church of Canada. I think that's everything that's in front of me. Can I forget anything? If there's anything else coming for the community at this time, please let me know. Okay, then let us join together in our call to worship. We are now alone.
We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect and creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus.
We gather in your presence today, seeking to follow the path of humility and service that Jesus has set out before us. Open our hearts to your love and guide us to live with compassion and grace towards others. Amen. Our offering, our offering has been gathered, our offering has been brought together in all the different ways, and we continue to support and sustain the important ministries here from St. Paul United, and for that we are thankful. Let us now join together in receiving the presentation of our offering.
Thank you.
all your faces. Some of you I haven't seen for a little while. You had a good summer? Yeah? I missed you. I have a question for you. Do you know what this animal is?
It's a goat.
It is an AI-generated goat. You're a genius. Wow, that was impressive. Did anyone else know that was an AI-generated goat? Because I don't even know how you know that. You're so smart. So, do you guys know any goats? No goats? No goats? Does goat also stand for something? Let's do the next one. Ah, the goat. The G-O-A-T. Do you know anyone who's the goat? The greatest of all time? So sometimes the goat is somebody who, the greatest of all time singer. You know the goat of singing? Who would that be? Taylor Swift? That's a good choice. So far, Taylor Swift is winning the game. And now she's playing football too, so it's impressive. Anyone else know what's like the goat of athletics?
Simone Biles.
Simone Biles is the goat of athletics. Yes, she is winning today. So the goat means in slang the greatest of all time. So there's lots of the greatest of all time. In today's Bible story, there's some disciples who are trying to figure out who the goat is. They're walking along, and Jesus has just been talking to them, and now they're walking behind him. Yeah, they're just hanging out. And they're talking, and Jesus can hear them talking behind them. He can hear them whispering to each other. And what they're whispering is, Jesus loves the most. And then it's like, no, I'm the best. Think of all the things I've done. I'm definitely the favorite. I'm definitely the goat. And then the other disciples are like, no, it's me. Can you hear this? It just really likes this conversation. It's totally what's happening. Oh, it's me. Jesus loves me the most. I'm the best. So then Jesus can hear them talking. And he says, what are you guys talking about? And they say, we're wondering who the best is. Now, what do you think Jesus answers them? Does he say, oh, wait, it's you? It's not all of them, it's you. Who do you think Jesus, how do you think Jesus addresses this? He does a really interesting thing. Jesus sits down. And he welcomes a child to come sit with him. Does anyone want to come sit with me? Yeah, come on. He welcomes a child to come sit with them. And he says to the disciples, if you want to be the goat, hi, thank you. If you want to be the goat, if you want to be the greatest of all time, what you have to do is welcome children. You have to be welcoming to the children, just like you. And when you welcome children, you welcome God. And God is love, right? So when we welcome children into our community and into our lives, when we're kind and generous to the vulnerable, to the small people around, then we are like God. We are just being loving like God is loving. And then that makes us get close to being the goat. Who do you think is the ultimate goat? When your minister asks you a question, the answer is God. Or Jesus. Yes, Jesus is the goat. So, want to have a little prayer before we go upstairs? That's all right. Come on down with me. How do we pray? Put our hands together and repeat after me. Thank you, God, for teaching us to be welcoming be loving and kind to everyone. Amen. Have a great day, you guys. You're the goat. You're all the goat. Let us pray. Oh God, your scriptures are a light to our path. They lead us through example, through teachings, through meditations. Please open our minds and open our hearts to hear your word for us today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So our scripture reading today is coming from the Gospel of Mark. And we're going to be reading a lot from the Gospel of Mark. And right now we're in chapter 9. And as I said, things are happening. Things are happening quickly. Things are moving right along. And what's happened just before this story is Jesus has, let's make sure I'm where it's gone. Yes, transfiguration. The story of Jesus up on the mountaintop, you know, he's transfigured, he's transformed, and like the disciples are amazed and terrified at the same time. They don't know what's happening. That's happened just before this story. So the disciples have kind of got a clue that something more than just regular everyday happenings are happening here. There's something more than they can understand. And the mysteries of the universe are happening with Jesus. But as we're going to talk about as we go through the Gospel of Mark, in the Gospel of Mark, the disciples usually are confused and they don't understand what's happening. They don't really get the whole story. They miss the point quite often and they have to be reminded and explained to, and that's part of Jesus' teaching. So maybe a little bit like us. I feel like we miss the mark. Sometimes, and hopefully Jesus is explaining to us confirming for us. So here we are in the story. Jesus is just basically the story I told the children. So have a listen in to what's being said and being done here. So starting in verse 30. When they left that place, they passed secretly through Galilee. And Jesus said to the disciples as they were traveling, "The Son of Man will be delivered into the hands of the people. They will kill him. And after he is killed, he will raise on the third day." But again, they did not understand his meaning, and they were afraid to ask him for an explanation. At last they came to Capernaum, where they gathered in a house. And Jesus said, "What was it I heard you arguing about along the way?" They looked down at the floor, but wouldn't answer, for they had been arguing among themselves who was the greatest of Jesus' disciples. Jesus sat down with the 12 to teach them. He said, "Whoever wants to be first must be last. Whoever wants to be the greatest must be the servant of all." And then he called forward a child, set the child in the middle of them, and took the child in his arms. And Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes a child like this in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." This is our gospel according to Mark. Thanks be to God. Our next hymn is Blessed Assurance, Voices United 337. Thank you. truly acceptable in your sight, our Lord and Redeemer. Amen. So, are you great? Are you awesome? Are you fantastic? Are you successful? I forgot. I kind of have to stay in one place. I have the mic where I can wander, but I won't wander too far. Do you know anyone who is great? Who is successful? Who's important? Do you know anyone who fits that criteria? And then, how are you determining that criteria? But what criteria do we measure success? That we measure greatness. We have people that we measure who are great, who are successful in various fields, like music and arts and entertainment, in sports, in politics, in life. We say that person has succeeded. What makes them a success? In Jesus' time, someone who was successful, someone who was the greatest, someone who had succeeded, it was very much tied to their honor within the society, within the culture. The person who was the most honored, the person who was the head of the table, who sat in the middle, who was the most honored in the society, would be deemed the greatest in the society. You know that one of my first loves is anthropology. I love cultural anthropology. It's weird, I know. Who else loves cultural anthropology like this? But I really do. I love looking at cultures and how they are formed and how they exist. And I've told you this before, one of the things that I look at is the societal norm, the societal way they regulate. And in Jesus' time, we've talked about this before, it was an honor-shame culture. It was a culture in which you wanted honor and you feared shame. You wanted honor and you wanted to make sure that you were in a place of honor and that your family was in a place of honor. And that meant many different things. But one of them was fulfilling the rules and the guidelines and the laws of the religion that was predominant at that time, the Hebrew tradition, where they followed the 613 laws, and many of those laws were centered around purity. And so having honor in that society meant that you were really good at following all of those rules. The other two major types of society are a fear safety society and a guilt innocence one. Today's society that we live in is predominantly focused on fear and safety. When you are the most powerful in the society, in our society, you're probably the safest in our society. You are safe from environmental harm because you probably have enough money to provide yourself protection from loss of power or loss of food sources. You have enough money or status that you would be put into a safe capsule if something devastating were happening with regard to like a war. You would be put in a place of safety. So those in the society who have the most power are the most safe. And those who don't live in this sort of world of fear of not having this safety. So it's a fear-safety society. The other type of society is guilt-innocence. And guilt-innocence society is kind of where we've come from. It was the predominant society up till semi-recently. Think about when, like TV shows from the 50s, the characters wanted to be innocent and not guilty of something. It comes from the Roman Catholic sort of basis of our society that we would have grown up in or themselves of their guilt. The reason you didn't do things back then was because you didn't want to be guilty. The reason we don't do things now is because we're afraid. Think of how parents parent now, like the helicopter parent. You don't want your kids to anything to happen to them. So we parent in this helicopter way. We have to keep them from being harmed by all the various things that can harm them. The internet can harm them. The angry people in the world that are doing harmful things can harm them. All of the different things that we're afraid of that will harm our children, we have to protect them from. So before we had to keep our children innocent, now we have to keep our children safe. And that is because we have this idea of children in our current culture and in our recent culture that children are precious. Children are special. Children are valued. They have a high value. So when I say this story of Jesus bringing the children and saying that we should welcome the children, we're all thinking, of course we should welcome the children. The children are wonderful. We want all the children, right? If I asked you to welcome more children to this church, you would be on board, right? No one would say, oh, no, we don't want kids to come here. Am I right? Okay, just general agreement is good. Okay, excellent. Because we value children in our current culture and time. We value them highly. This is a different culture. Both guilt, innocent, fear, safety cultures were different. In the honor, shame culture that Jesus was living in, children were viewed very, very differently. They were almost afraid of children, if that makes sense. At the time, it was very important, right, to maintain your honor. And to maintain your honor, that meant following all the laws. And part of the laws were about remaining ritually clean. And so there were lots of things in society that can make you ritually unclean. And the big problem with being ritually unclean was that you could not go and be in the community. You would be exiled. You couldn't go to worship. You would lose honor. And so this way that the children were seen at the time will be the way we see people who are marginalized. It will be the way we see people who are outside. And Jesus is saying to those who are marginalized, to those who are outside of our societal norms, those are who he is welcoming. He flips over what the society norms at the time. The other disciples and other stories about this are saying to the children, no, stay away, because they know there's a risk. Children are risky. And if they come up and sit with Jesus, they might make him ritually unclean. They might cause him to be outside of the society. And the disciples don't want that for Jesus. So they're saying to them, stay away. They have this idea that they might make Jesus, so what would we say in previous culture, guilty. In today's culture, unsafe. But Jesus, as always, turns that on its head. And he says, no, to the ones that we see as guilty, to the ones that we see as unsafe, to the ones that we see as shameful, we welcome. And when we welcome them, we are welcoming God. And we are welcoming like God. So what makes us great? What makes us successful? Society would tell us that greatness comes from power, from wealth, from status. That greatness comes from ability. But Jesus teaches us that greatness comes from humility, from service, from welcoming the least in our society, from looking to those who are marginalized, to those who are oppressed, to those who are facing hardship and saying, I need to serve these people. I need to work for these people. I need to make myself least and lift these people up. And it doesn't take us long if we sit for a few minutes to think of in our society who those people might be. Who are the people that wouldn't be welcomed into our church would be. If I did a poll and asked who we generally agree on, to the people that wouldn't be welcomed in our society. There are many well-known figures throughout human history who are known to be great, and with good cause. They have done great and wonderful things. But there's also so many people throughout history who we don't know, who followed this call of service, who lifted up others, risking their own safety so that others might be made safe. I want to tell you a story today, a story that I read this week, about Irina Sendler. There are many wonderful, heroic people that we know from the World War II stories. We know Oscar Schindler, who's that movie, Schindler's List, where he ran a factory and he saved 1,000 people from the concentration camp because they worked with him in his factory. We know the story of Anne Frank and her diary, and we know about the story of the people who so bravely hid the Frank family. But this is another story. This is about Irina Sendler. And you may or may not have ever heard of her, but she was a hero. She was living in Poland, and she was 29 when the German forces invaded Poland. And she was working as a social worker. And she continued her work as a social worker after the invasion, and soon discovered that the Jewish people who were being kept in the Warsaw Ghetto, which was in Poland, were suffering, and they needed help. So she began helping them. She began sneaking in provisions for them. But what she soon discovered is that the parents in the Warsaw Ghetto knew that things were just going to get worse, and they feared for their children. So they were trying to find ways of getting their children out. So Irina took it upon herself to begin the work of hiding these children and smuggling them out of this ghetto. She had people help her, people that she trusted. She hid children in boxes. She hid children in suitcases. She hid children in coffins. To little babies, she would give them a sedative so that they wouldn't make any noise. The parents trusted her to take their children to safety. She painstakingly wrote down all of their original names and then proceeded to give them new names and new documents, to send them to orphanages and convents to live with other families so that they might be safe. One night, in the middle of this, the Gestapo knocked on her door and they arrested her because they knew that she was doing something. They tortured her. They tortured her so much that she was, her legs and her feet were broken, and she wasn't able to use them correctly ever again. They sent her to be executed, and she was in line to be executed when a soldier who had been bribed by the Polish resistance sent the people ahead of her and then pushed her out of the way and said, run. And she, unable to run, figured out a way to get out of that situation and went right back to saving children. She went right back to it. The numbers are sketchy, we're not sure, but it's around 2,500 children that she saved. She was never formally recognized until much later in her life because she never really told the story. Because for most of her life, she felt bad about it. Because she felt like, I should have done more. I could have done more. She said it was a regret that would follow her to her death. Because she just felt like there were more that could have been saved. After the war was over, she used these little slips of paper that she had hidden so carefully so that she might try to reunite these children with their parents or their families. Unfortunately, most of their families were gone. Most of their families had been sent to death camps and to never return. Can you imagine? That is the level of greatness that we can aspire to. That is one person who saw something and made a choice and who changed the world. One person who heard Jesus' call that we are supposed to be working for the people who need us the most. That our call to greatness is to work for the least and the most vulnerable in our society. Who are they? Can we see them? And what can we do? Every week, it's not easy being a Christian. It is not easy to follow Jesus because we have to work every day to hear this call that it is about putting others first. It is about God's kingdom of love in the world where we serve the least, where we strive to save those who cannot save themselves, to find safety for those who cannot find safety for themselves. Serving with humility and love is the teaching of Jesus over and over and over again. And as disciples of Christ, this is who we are called to be. This is the good news. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we come before you with humble hearts, recognizing that true greatness in your kingdom is found not in power or prestige, but in serving one another with love. We pray for your guidance as we seek to follow the example of Jesus, who came not to be served, but to serve. O God, we lift up to you those in our community and in the world who are vulnerable, those who are struggling, and those who are in need of your healing and comfort. May we be instruments of your peace, offering support and compassion to those who feel alone or forgotten. Teach us to be your hands and your feet, reaching out in love to all who cross our path. O God, we pray for our leaders, that they may govern with wisdom and humility, seeking justice for the least and the lost. We ask for your persistence in places of conflict, your presence in places of conflict and pain and suffering, bringing hope and healing where it is needed most. O God, we pray for those in our congregation and beyond who are facing illness, grief, or hardship. We ask for your strength and your comfort, O God. Surround them with your love and your care from this community. And help us, O God, to live out the greatness to which you call us, not by seeking recognition, but by loving and serving with all that we are. Let our lives reflect your grace, and our actions bring light and love to this world. God of compassion and caring, we pray silently for those that we hold in our hearts this day. each and every one of us, to share this good news with the community around us, to share the good news of God's love for each and every one of us. Let us grow with the love of God, peace of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.